McGraw-Hill Professional presents Zero Harm, How to Achieve Patient and Workforce Safety in Healthcare. Edited by Craig Clapper, Physical Engineer, Dr. James Merlino, and Carole Stockmeier. Narrated by Gary MacFadden. Foreword, Dr. Thomas H. Lee, Master of Science. During my childhood, my Chinese immigrant parents exposed me in countless ways to elements of Chinese philosophy. The central questions of this philosophy: what does it mean to be good? What can I do to become better? Were baked into the way my parents lived their lives and raised my brothers and me. More recently, I've come to realize that these are the very same questions we in healthcare ask all the time, or should ask. Zero Harm is a powerful inquiry into what good is in healthcare, and how we and our organizations can achieve it. The book recognizes that the answers are complex, interesting, and challenging, that they involve far more than simply following a set of rules. Rules, protocols, and processes are, of course, vitally important in healthcare. Before performing a physical examination on a patient, the rule says you should always wash your hands. Before inserting a central line, you should check a patient's coagulation status. But on so many occasions, rules don't suffice. What rules should a clinician follow in deciding when to begin discussing end-of-life care preferences with a patient? What rules dictate to clinicians how to build trust and respect among other caregivers with whom they collaborate? It is in such vast gray zones that highly reliable healthcare organizations demonstrate that they possess more than just policies and procedures. They have philosophies and cultures. As the chapters in this book demonstrate, organizational philosophies and cultures bear on all aspects of performance, including safety, patient experience, technical excellence, and efficiency. Individuals and teams can't improve in these areas simply by following new and better rules. Rather, they need a basic set of values, norms, and behaviors in place that they can judiciously apply in the moment to address specific situations. When asked what it meant to be good, Confucius famously gave different answers in different contexts. In his view, people couldn't define goodness by mindlessly applying rules. Rather, goodness followed from learning behaviors and developing instincts that equip us to do the best we can in any situation, however unpredictable it might prove to be. Throughout my career in the United States, I've been amazed at how many of my colleagues have seemed to practice in accord with Confucius's teachings. They don't like it when organizations define excellence in rule-bound ways, and they are even ambivalent about guidelines. Certainly, they have a point. I don't know any quality measures that define the proper course of action in every situation. I can always cite a reason why a rule might harm some patient I have seen in the past or might see in the future. Such concerns cause all of us to shift restlessly in our seats when we receive quality data suggesting room for improvement, and they provide us with an easy way to resist the imperative to improve. At the same time, we must improve. We all know that patients are injured as a result of our efforts to help them, and that they endure unnecessary suffering and fear. These challenges only increase as medical progress accelerates. More people have to work together to provide state-of-the-science care, and those people often maintain increasingly narrower perspectives. Opportunities for errors, intentional or not, proliferate. What would Confucius do? I actually think he would embrace the safety science approaches embedded in this book. The book's authors cover a variety of topics, but they share a common understanding of culture as the primary vehicle of improvement. They urge us to aim for zero harm and zero worker injury by embracing a culture of high reliability, one whose values and norms are embraced by leadership and frontline personnel alike. They urge us to foster teamwork and strong team cultures, and to push ourselves every day to improve what we do. Another theme of Confucius's teaching present in this book concerns the use of ritual. Life is complicated, and we often don't know quite how to behave. Happily, rituals serve us as frequent, predictable moments in which we can behave as if we are actualizing our best selves. An older person enters the room, and you stand up as if you were respectful. A colleague does you a small favor, and you say thank you, as if you were grateful. Using ritual to behave as if we were good is not hypocritical, any more than everyday manners are willfully deceptive. Performing rituals conforms to clinicians' common understanding that they are on stage every time they begin a patient encounter. And rituals also have important implications for safety. Regular, ritualistic behaviors allow us to anchor ourselves, making desirable behaviors more likely when we really need them. One ritual that appears on the surgical checklist used at many institutions calls for everyone to pause and introduce him or herself prior to the procedure. Doing so consistently affirms everyone's status as an equal member of a team, which in turn helps non-physicians feel comfortable speaking up when they see something going awry. The more often they speak up, the more likely it is that teams will prevent potentially deadly errors. I first connected Confucius's teachings about ritual with my clinical work when I encountered data showing that clinicians should sit down in a chair when talking to hospitalized patients who were lying in bed. This recommendation forms part of the work that defined Press Ganey's Compassionate Connected Care Framework, as described in Press Ganey Chief Nursing Officer Christy Dempsey's recent book, The Antidote to Suffering. As I began presenting these data myself and making that recommendation nationally, I knew I had to adopt it in my own clinical work. When I walked into patients' rooms to find that family members were using every chair, I made myself pause and say, "Let me find a chair so we can talk." Often, someone from the family would offer me his or her chair, and I almost always took it. I'm not a saint. But I compelled myself to communicate at the same level as the patient, behaving as if I was respectful, genuinely wanted to understand the patient's opinions, and wouldn't be hurried. I don't know for sure what impact this new habit had on my patients, but I do know that behaving as if allowed me to feel better as a physician and as a person. Confucius's thinking about ritual conforms well with the recommendations for specific daily habits sprinkled throughout this book. At the same time, I hope readers won't get so lost in the specificity that they miss the loftiness of the book's ambitions and implications. Its authors seek nothing less than the transformation of healthcare's culture, so that individuals and teams can deliver care that is reliably safe, empathic, and technically excellent. As we all improve, and as our organizations grow closer to zero harm and zero workplace injury, we'll gain satisfaction in knowing that we are not just serving patients better and keeping them safe, but are ourselves noble and becoming more so every day. Introduction. Craig Clapper, physical engineer, certified manager of quality and organizational excellence. Too many patients are harmed each year in U.S. healthcare settings. The numbers vary, but they're all frightening. According to the 1999 IOM, Institute of Medicine, Report, to err is human. Errors and omissions lead to 98,000 patient deaths every year. One patient death every 5 minutes, 22 seconds. A more recent 2016 estimate of patient harm found that errors and omissions were the third leading cause of mortality in healthcare, accounting for 251,000 deaths each year, or one every 2 minutes, 6 seconds. The highest estimate, published in 2013 in the Journal of Patient Safety, ascribed 440,000 patient deaths per year to errors or omissions, or one every 1 minute, 11 seconds. It's not just patients who suffer from accidental harm, but employees. The Bureau of Labor Statistics, BLS, reports the illness and injury data that healthcare administrators submit to the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA. The best measure of workforce safety is the total case incident rate, or TCIR, defined as the number of OSHA recordable injuries for every 200,000 hours worked. For hospitals in 2016, the mean TCIR was 5.9. That is, about 6 of every 100 full-time employees were injured on the job that year, assuming that the typical full-time employee works 2,000 hours annually. In long-term care settings, about 6.4 out of 100 employees were injured, while ambulatory care was safer, with only 2.3% of employees injured. These numbers might not sound large, but consider this. Between 1985 and 1995, when I worked in the U.S. nuclear power industry, our total case incident rate was only 0.3, 20 times lower than healthcare today. The costs that accrue due to poor workforce safety are also staggering. In 2011, healthcare organizations suffered some $13.1 billion in losses and more than 2 million lost workdays. Money is important, but we should also remember that injuries and harm produce pain and suffering for large numbers of people. Patients suffer directly when they experience harm, and also when errors or omissions prevented them from obtaining positive outcomes they otherwise would have experienced. As Christy Dempsey relates in her book, The Antidote to Suffering, patients suffer even when they do receive a positive outcome, if their care was neither compassionate nor connected. Caregivers and providers also suffer when their organizations don't respect them for the contributions they make, when they don't feel engaged in meaningful work, and when they're injured on the job. Our work now as healthcare leaders is to dramatically reduce this suffering. But how? Aim for zero harm. This book argues that healthcare organizations should adopt zero harm as their goal, and that they should apply proven principles of safety science to make that goal a reality. Zero is the only acceptable number in safety. Leaders, administrators, clinicians, and employees can and must work tirelessly and in the best interests of our patients and workforce until we have zero preventable harm and zero injury. A number of healthcare executives have rallied behind the cause of zero harm. In 2011, Dr. Don Kinnerly, then at Baylor Healthcare System, argued for three zeros: zero preventable deaths, zero preventable injuries, and zero preventable risks. Likewise, James Skogsberg, Chief Executive Officer of Advocate Healthcare, along with Drs. Lee Sachs and Rishi Sika, physician executives at Advocate, observed the critical role that mindful leadership plays for organizations pursuing zero harm. Most safety leaders in the Healthcare Performance Improvement, HPI, Press Ganey client community have signed on to the Zero Harm Commitment, a Press Ganey movement launched by Jack Lynch, Chief Executive Officer of Mainline Health, to organize the patient experience around safety and the goal of zero harm. And yet, some healthcare leaders continue to resist the notion of zero harm, perceiving it as an unrealistic goal. They observe that even if an organization reduces the incidences of harm by 50% every 2 years, it might get close to zero, but it will never quite reach it. It's simple math. Zero is an asymptote. Or is it? Safety science holds that zero is possible. As an organization reduces harm and injury, the numbers get increasingly small. First, the organization achieves zero harm for a day. Then it goes an entire week without an injury or incidence of harm. Then an entire month. And finally, at some point, it reaches zero for a year. Doug Cropper, chief executive at Genesis Health System in the Quad Cities of Iowa and Illinois, led his system to zero. Genesis defined patient harm as preventable harm greater than or equal to moderate temporary harm. A patient who experienced a mild and temporary skin reaction as the result of a medication error wouldn't have reached the threshold of moderate temporary patient harm under this definition. But one who experienced a wrong site surgery resulting in loss of organ function or a medication error requiring supportive care in the intensive care unit would have. Genesis measured harm at any point in time by counting the number of qualifying incidents that had occurred over the preceding 12 months. When the organization achieved 12 consecutive months without serious preventable harm, it arrived at zero. For now. If and when another harm occurs, Genesis will no longer be at zero. Some healthcare leaders argue that even if zero harm is realistic, organizations can't afford to aim for this goal. Here again, the naysayers seem to have mathematics on their side. If you treat safety improvements as a set of external rules or processes an organization tacks on to patient care, the work system becomes more complex, and costs increase as you move to improve safety. Unfortunately, harm and injury will also usually increase as a work system becomes more complex, leading to failure all around. But when you approach safety as a means of also increasing a work system's reliability, you wind up simplifying the work system and making it less prone to errors. Harm and injury decline, and so does cost, because the work system becomes more efficient. Safety doesn't mean more controls in a work system. It means better work systems. We've seen other industries become more reliable and less costly as they've increased safety. As Dempsey notes in The Antidote to Suffering, the nuclear power industry saw the number of safety events decrease by 70.6% over the years 1995 to 2005. But the costs of production fell as well, by 28.7%. The industry didn't pay more for safety. Rather, safety allowed the industry to operate more efficiently. Data about cost savings in healthcare are equally compelling. Studies of return on investment in the HPI client community show companies reaping value that outpaces costs by factors ranging from 2 to 1 to 5 to 1 over 3 years, with most of the real savings coming in the form of lower costs related to insurance, claims, and settlements, and the treatments of hospital-acquired conditions, or HACs. How quickly might other healthcare organizations hope to see significant improvements by applying safety science? The answer might surprise you. I trained in safety science and high reliability organizing while working for Dr. Chong Chu at Failure Prevention Inc., FPI, in San Clemente, California. Trained as an engineer at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Chu was an innovator in nuclear power safety and safety culture, and he was also quite a character. He theorized that complex systems such as manufacturing operations, chemical plants, and nuclear power plants could reduce loss events by 80% every 2 years 2 years is an average improvement cycle for transformational cultural change in a large organization. A nuclear power plant that formerly suffered 100 precursor safety events each year would experience only 20 per year after an improvement cycle of 2 years. After a second 2-year improvement cycle, it would experience only 5 per year. That's a 95% reduction over 4 years. In reality, we achieved reductions of 75% over 4 years. Not too shabby. Carrie Johnson was my longtime partner with Chongchu and later at Healthcare Performance Improvement, HPI, before its acquisition by Press Ganey. We applied the same safety science, high reliability organizing methods to companies in power, transportation, manufacturing, and, for the last 18 years, healthcare. Whenever we brought safety science to a new industry, we encountered skepticism. How did we know that what worked in a nuclear plant would work at a coal plant? How did we know that what worked in power generation would work in power transmission and distribution? What evidence did we have that we could apply aviation safety practices in railroads, shipping, or trucking? How did we know that what worked for safety in power and transportation would work in heavy manufacturing? In each new industry, we answered such skepticism by producing results. On the order of an 80% reduction in safety incidents every 2 years. In 2015, when HPI joined forces with Press Ganey, the two organizations shared a common vision. Under the leadership of CEO Patrick Ryan, Press Ganey had committed itself to an ambitious project of transforming multiple facets of healthcare, including safety, clinical quality, and patient experience. Meanwhile, we were a small Virginia Beach, Virginia-based healthcare consulting group dedicated solely to the first of these goals, reducing patient harm and workforce injury by applying safety science high reliability principles. As Pat clearly saw, healthcare had impeded progress by reducing the measurement and improvement of patient experience to the measurement of satisfaction. Calling patient experience satisfaction diminished the importance of the patient experience, and it also failed to engage clinicians, since they wanted to improve the quality of patient care. To spur change, Ryan assembled an impressive group of thought leaders, including Dr. Thomas Lee, Christina Dempsey, and Dr. James Merlino. I invite you to learn more about the patient experience in Jim Merlino's book, Service Fanatics, and about the broader changes required in Tom Lee's book, An Epidemic of Empathy in Healthcare. Today, we know that safety science is universally relevant, not limited to a particular industry, company, or location. We also know that it works in healthcare. Over 80 healthcare systems currently deploy our approach to safety culture transformation, including 1,200 hospitals, as well as post-acute care, home health, physician practice sites, and other facilities. These organizations haven't achieved zero harm yet, but with continued diligence, they very well could. Bear in mind, though, the point is not simply to reach zero once. It's to reach it for a period of time before faltering, and then to reach it again, and then again, staying at zero for progressively longer periods. If we experience one patient death every 7 days, let's improve that to one death every 30 days. Then let's improve that to one death every 365 days. Likewise, if your organization is experiencing 3 worker injuries per day, aim to get that down to 1 per day. Then improve that to 1 per week. Perhaps one day you'll see 0 worker injuries for an entire month or year. It's a realistic goal, and the effort you make to attain it will improve your organization's financial performance in the process. About this book. Zero Harm provides a comprehensive overview of safety science as well as frameworks for reducing safety incidences to zero in your organization. We've written this book for anyone in healthcare interested in safety, including safety experts, quality experts, leaders, caregivers, patients, and their families. The chapters that follow provide a comprehensive guide to building a safety strategy, but readers can also consult them separately as handy references on specific safety topics. For readers looking simply to learn the basics of patient and workforce safety, we hope Zero Harm will serve as an accessible introduction both to safety culture and its transformation. The book's first three chapters lay the foundation for readers' safety improvement efforts. In Chapter 1, Dr. Gary Yates, an HPI Press Ganey partner and former physician executive with Centara Healthcare, offers a brief but essential history of the modern patient safety movement in healthcare, describing both the general trajectory and watershed events. Carole Stockmeier, also an HPI Press Ganey partner and a former safety and reliability leader from Centara, goes on in Chapter 2 to provide an overview of safety management systems, or SMS. Several published works describe safety management systems in other industries, but no safety management system book currently exists for healthcare. Healthcare systems are complex, so much so that we can't achieve safety improvements without a formal management system in place. I proceed to further lay the foundation for safety improvement efforts in Chapter 3 by discussing safety science and high reliability organizing, HRO. Safety science comprises the knowledge and practice of system controls to prevent harm and injury. High reliability organizing is a body of knowledge describing the attributes of organizations that achieve strong safety records under very trying conditions. As we'll see, the key principles of safety science and high reliability organizations will inspire the practical methods for improving safety surveyed in subsequent chapters. In Chapter 4, Steve Kreiser, also an HPI Press Ganey partner and a former naval aviator with commercial aviation experience, begins the work of putting principles into practice. He discusses several high-leverage leadership skills that your organization will need in order to make progress on safety, drawing examples from healthcare as well as naval aviation. Culture is the shadow cast by leadership, so if you're a leader or manager, this is the chapter you'll want to know, speak to, and live. Shannon Sales, a nurse and senior managing consultant with HPI Press Ganey, continues the work of putting principles into practice in Chapter 5 with the discussion of universal skills for preventing harm. Universal skills are non-technical skills or behaviors shared by all caregivers and providers, and indeed among all job functions in all industries. They include attention, thinking, communication, and compliance skills, as well as the ability to use guidance documents effectively. As you might be surprised to discover, consistent application of these skills could prevent roughly 3 out of every 4 acts leading to serious preventable harm. David Barnes, also a senior managing consultant and a former naval aviator, will continue the discussion of universal skills in Chapter 6 with an eye toward communication, collegiality, and teaming. To think together as a care delivery team, team members must deploy universal relationship skills so as to tame the distancing effects of power inequalities on the team. Dave will discuss relationship skills as companion skills to the universal skills Shannon covers. We return to the topic of leadership in Chapter 7. Judith Ewald, also an HPI Press Ganey senior managing consultant and a former safety and quality leader from Innova Health System, argues that a strong safety culture cannot exist simply by articulating cultural norms. Leaders must also hold people accountable, and create a learning environment so that caregivers and providers can improve the larger systems in which they work. Safety leaders should always support team members who make honest mistakes, and they should save those who choose at-risk behaviors by meting out progressive discipline. Isn't that an odd turn of phrase? Save team members with discipline? Too often, healthcare leaders would rather ignore poor practice until it's too late to save the job of a caregiver or provider. As safety leaders, we can save caregivers from their own poor practices by holding them accountable proactively with just culture principles. In Chapter 8, Sherry Throop, a nurse and HPI Press Ganey Senior Managing Consultant, and Martin Wright, Director in Workforce Solutions with Press Ganey Strategic Consulting, describe the importance of measurement and control loops for patient safety and workforce safety. Healthcare leaders understand measurement quite well, and Sherry and Marty will provide a sound system of leading, real-time, and lagging measures for both patient and workforce safety. Control loops are management systems that monitor for deviation in a measure, prompt us to solve for system problems leading to the poor performance, provide a countermeasure to improve performance, and allow for continued monitoring. It's the strength of the control loop that dictates performance, not the strength of the measure. Tamara Strong, a director in HBI Press Ganey and a nurse, continues in Chapter 9 with a detailed treatment of learning systems, processes, or procedures for discerning and addressing errors. Safety culture requires mechanisms for learning because all complex systems operate in a degraded mode, with problems lurking beneath the surface. Healthcare likely puts too much emphasis on achieving big performance improvements, a small number of large changes, and too little emphasis on small performance improvement via daily, informal problem solving on the part of teams, local learning systems. As Tammy urges in Chapter 9, we should put more energy into local learning, mindful of the old bromide, improvement by the yard is hard. Improvement by the inch is a cinch. So far, the book has focused on patient safety. In Chapter 10, Emily Halu, a staff consultant with HBI Press Ganey and also a nurse, and Joseph Cabral, Press Ganey's Chief Human Resources Officer, offer a standalone primer on workforce safety, describing the powerful connection that exists between workforce safety and engagement. Emily and Joe provide a compelling case for taking action and then go on to discuss the solutions available to organizations. It turns out that the safety culture, leadership skills, and universal skills prescribed by Emily and Joe are the same as those for patient safety. The big difference is the use of safety action teams to identify and correct system problems for 5 types of workforce injury. Deirdre Mylod, Executive Director for the Press Ganey Innovations Institute, Stacy Pallotta, formerly of the Cleveland Clinic and now a partner in Press Ganey Consulting for Patient Experience, and Dr. Thomas Lee, Press Ganey's Chief Medical Officer, go on in Chapter 11 to share our latest thinking on high reliability organizing, or HRO, for the patient experience. Patient experience comprises patient safety, clinical quality, and experience of care. Safety, and the high reliability demanded to keep people safe, has a profound effect on patient experience. Deirdre, Stacy, and Tom provide a short history of patient experience measurement and improvement, and a case study on leading practices. Finally, they help us see around the corner to the next wave of innovation in patient experience. Dr. James Merlino, Press Ganey's Chief Transformation Officer and also formerly of the Cleveland Clinic, discusses transformational change in the epilogue. Tying the book together, he provides a blueprint for change across the entire healthcare enterprise. All of the authors recognize that no doctor, nurse, administrator, technician, or other provider or caregiver ever wants to cause harm, see a patient or colleague harmed, or become involved in an incident of harm. But many of us still haven't dedicated ourselves, our teams, and our organizations to safety. If you fall into this group, I hope you'll become a true safety zealot after reading this book. Understand that safety is not just inherently valuable, but also the best possible producer of quality, patient experience, workforce and physician engagement, and efficiency. Know that if some safety is good, more of it is even better. And total safety, zero harm, is the ultimate goal. If you're already a safety zealot, I hope reading this book puts you in a better position to improve safety at your organization, and that you'll feel even more emboldened in your efforts. Think of it. The insights contained in Zero Harm are based on learning that occurred as a result of the deaths of an estimated 4,600,000 people in healthcare, power, transportation, and manufacturing. Please don't waste lessons so costly learned. Just a single framework or tactic presented in Zero Harm can create a ripple effect in your organization that might save 60 lives over 2 years. And that's only the beginning. Rededicate yourself to eradicating errors and injuries entirely. The chapter authors in this book and I desperately want your organization to experience zero harm. And that's what you should want too. For the patients you serve, their families, and the caregivers and providers who have devoted their lives to serving others. Chapter 1. The History of the Modern Safety Movement. Dr. Gary Yates. Although healthcare leaders first began focusing on patient safety during the 1980s and 1990s, concerted efforts to improve safety remained few and far between. In 1999, a courageous group of healthcare quality leaders decided to go public with the issue, sparking a dialogue that continues to this day. Unfortunately, almost 20 years later, despite well-intentioned efforts by hospitals and health systems and over $1 billion in financial support from CMS, the rate of patient harm remains unacceptable. Our patients and communities deserve better. My introduction to medical error came in 1979, during my fifth week as a newly minted third-year medical student. A resident physician and I were making rounds on a relatively quiet Saturday morning when we encountered a patient who had received the wrong dose of a medication, likely because of poor communication between our service and one of the other surgical teams. When I asked my intern about it, he suggested that we ignore the incident and move on, lest we risk embarrassing the clinicians involved. "Gary," he said, "this kind of thing happens." Avoiding open discussion of safety issues was an unfortunate part of the culture of healthcare back then, and patients and caregivers paid an enormous price. In the decades since, we've seen the birth of the modern patient safety movement in the United States, as well as the erosion of the culture of silence. Hospitals, health systems, and other healthcare providers have all taken important steps to eliminate unintended harm. Still, progress has been disappointingly slow. In a 2017 survey of 2,536 adults, 21% of respondents reported having personally experienced a medical error, while 31% reported that someone else whose care they were involved with experienced an error. As survey respondents confirmed, harm often had a lasting impact on patients' physical health, emotional health, financial well-being, or their family relationships. Those who provide the care also suffer harm. As we saw in the introduction, The Bureau of Labor Statistics found that in 2016, hospital employees experienced 6 cases of injury and illness for every 100 full-time workers, much more than in industries like manufacturing and construction. Clearly, unintended harm is still affecting unbelievably large numbers of people. Patient safety experts generally agree that we'll have to make fundamental and wide-ranging changes before we achieve the ultimate goal: zero harm for patients. But why hasn't healthcare yet managed to solve the problem of patient harm? And what will the future likely hold? Origins of the modern safety movement. For decades, clinicians involved in harm events generally suffered in silence or quietly shared stories with one another. Hospital and health system leaders, along with the attorneys with whom they worked, knew of allegations of harm thanks to the lawsuits and claims filed by patients and their families. Occasionally, a case would break through into the news media, focusing the general public's attention on safety issues in healthcare. In 1966, the popular weekly magazine, Look, ran a lead article with the cover headline, "Our Hospitals Are Killing Us," an alarming report on conditions in many American cities. The article, entitled "Dirt, Infection, Error, and Negligence: The Hidden Death Threats in Our Hospitals," described potentially harmful conditions that routinely existed in hospitals, along with observations from physician leaders about deficiencies in hospitals and care and the need to correct them. Stories like these didn't provoke a strong public reaction or widespread calls for change from within the medical community. To most people, instances of patient harm seemed uncommon and idiosyncratic. Within the medical community, some viewed errors as the price to be paid for technological advances, while others regarded them as an unavoidable part of delivering care. Many viewed errors as reflecting the personal failings of the caregivers involved, rather than the limitations of the healthcare system as a whole. Dr. Lucian Leap, Master of Public Health, regarded by many as the father of the patient safety movement, once observed that physicians are expected to function without error, an expectation that physicians translate into the need to be infallible. One result is that physicians, not unlike test pilots, come to view an error as a failure of character. You weren't careful enough. You didn't try hard enough. By the 1980s, a few visionaries within the medical field were beginning to think differently. Dr. Leap, for instance, served as lead author on a series of influential research articles about safety. Evaluating care at 51 New York State hospitals, his group found that 3.7% of the 30,195 randomly selected patients sustained an injury that resulted in a clear disability or a longer hospital stay. They also found that errors in management contributed to 58% of the instances of harm, and that the rates of adverse events rose with a patient's age. In 1991, Leap and his colleagues published similarly unsettling findings from a study of the Harvard medical practice in the New England Journal of Medicine. Predictably, the medical community's response was muted. Many physicians and healthcare leaders couldn't believe that preventable patient harm could occur so frequently in what many regarded as the world's highest quality healthcare system. Undeterred, Leap continued to study medical errors, publishing the landmark article, "Error in Medicine," in the December 1994 edition of the Journal of the American Medical Association, JAMA. Leap argued that healthcare should look to other industries that had been able to significantly reduce errors, and that healthcare would need to take a preventative, systemic approach in order to significantly improve patient safety. Accident prevention has not been a primary focus of the practice of hospital medicine, he observed, noting that the most fundamental change that will be needed if hospitals are to make meaningful progress in error reduction is a cultural one. Errors must be accepted as evidence of systems flaws, not character flaws. Until and unless that happens, it is unlikely that any substantial progress will be made in reducing medical errors. By the mid-1990s, public pressure for change was beginning to mount, thanks in part to media coverage. In September 1993, Betsy Lehman, the Boston Globe's chief medical reporter, a mother of two, and the wife of a cancer researcher, was diagnosed with breast cancer. With standard treatment only partially effective, she elected to undergo an autologous stem cell transplant, an aggressive but promising treatment at the time. In November 1994, she sought care at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Despite early signs that her malignancy was beginning to respond, she passed away in the hospital, presumably due to complications of her disease. Several months later, a routine data check of the experimental protocol in which she had participated revealed that Betsy had received 4 times the intended dose of Cytoxan, a powerful chemotherapy agent. Her death likely occurred thanks to the overdose, not her disease itself. The media picked up Betsy's story, raising disturbing questions. How could such an error occur at one of the world's finest cancer centers? If it could happen to the wife of a cancer expert, what risks did patients with relatively limited medical knowledge bear? In its April 1995 piece, entitled "The Disturbing Case of the Cure That Killed the Patient," Time magazine described Betsy Lehman's case, as well as other horrific incidences from around the country, in which patients had the wrong leg amputated, had the wrong breast removed, had their breathing machine inadvertently turned off, or had died after undergoing a routine tonsillectomy. As the article noted, 3 large studies over the past 30 years have documented a distressingly consistent rate of medical mishaps in the U.S. That toll is a sign to some critics that improvement is needed in the systems that hospitals use to catch errors and review doctors' performance. By 1996, the healthcare profession was beginning to take such criticism seriously. In October of that year, the American Medical Association, the Joint Commission, the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences, and the Annenberg Center for Health Sciences sponsored one of the first conferences to publicly acknowledge the issue of harm and discuss ways to deal with it. The Annenberg Conference program's opening sentence stated, "Despite remarkable advances in almost every field of medicine, an age-old problem continues to haunt medical care: the occurrence of errors." It was a remarkable and courageous statement by this group. The conference led to the creation, the following year, of the National Patient Safety Foundation, NPSF, one of the first organizations that focused on safety. The NPSF was designed to be a collaborative body, a kind of Switzerland that convened and coordinated efforts to accelerate improvement in patient safety. Through sponsored studies, white papers, and other thought leadership activities, NPSF has gone on to provide significant support for a number of important patient safety initiatives. In 2007, the NPSF's Lucian Leap Institute was created to provide a national vision for improving patient safety. By the late 1990s, others within the healthcare profession were becoming similarly emboldened. Harvard-trained pediatrician Dr. Don Berwick had become a student of modern industrial quality improvement, looking to W. Edwards Deming, Joseph Juran, and others for approaches that would reduce errors and improve the quality of care. As part of his pioneering work, Berwick founded the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, IHI, which continues to serve as a leader in improving healthcare quality and patient safety. In 2017, the organization merged with the NPSF to form a single, powerful organization dedicated to this cause. As Berwick has related, his thinking about patient safety evolved based on the care his wife, Anne, received in several leading U.S. hospitals. In 1999, he noted that he had seen safety problems firsthand, sitting by Anne's bedside for week after week of acute care. The errors were not rare, they were the norm. Although Anne began to recover, the experience was eye-opening. "Before this, I was concerned," Berwick said. "Now I am radicalized. If what happened to Anne could happen in our best institutions, I wonder more than ever before what the average must be like." At about this time, the Institute of Medicine of the National Academies launched the Quality of Healthcare in America project, now the National Academy of Medicine. The project convened a number of distinguished members, including Drs. Leap and Berwick, and was charged with devising strategies that would result in major improvements in care quality. Members of the group had grown frustrated that few organizations had moved to improve patient safety, despite clear evidence that significant problems existed. The group issued a general report highlighting significant opportunities to improve healthcare quality, but failed to garner much attention in professional circles. The group therefore made the courageous decision to go public with the problem, seeking to use public interest and concern as a lever to spur healthcare leaders to take action. In late 1999, the group released a report exclusively focused on patient safety and medical errors called "To Err is Human: Building a Safer Health System." The report became national news, appearing on the front pages of The Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, USA Today, and other publications. Journalists were especially interested in the report's assertion, based on data from a Harvard medical practice study and a Utah and Colorado study, that medical error led to the deaths of between 44,000 and 98,000 Americans each year. That was about as many as would die if a fully loaded Boeing 747 aircraft were to crash each day. The IOM report and the subsequent public reaction stimulated a flurry of activity in the medical community to acknowledge and address the patient safety issue. For this reason, many today regard the report as marking the beginning of the modern safety movement in healthcare. The same committee produced a second report in 2001, Crossing the Quality Chasm: A New Health System for the 21st Century, which looked more broadly at improvements needed in the health system. As the committee asserted, the system should aim to produce care that is safe, effective, patient-centered, timely, efficient, and equitable. This report received more attention within the healthcare community than among the general public, providing a valuable framework for improving not just safety, but other key elements of patient care. In particular, the report's concept of becoming patient-centric, placing the patient and his or her family at the center of care, was provocative at the time, and has since become a primary focus of many health organizations. As the safety movement gained momentum, another patient story rocked the industry and one of its most highly regarded institutions. In 2001, 18-month-old Josie King was brought to Baltimore's Johns Hopkins Hospital for burn care. During her hospitalization, her family became concerned that Josie wasn't doing well and that her caregivers weren't listening to their concerns as attentively as they might have. Despite warning signs of clinical deterioration, Josie passed away due to dehydration that was possibly exacerbated by side effects from pain medications. Afterward, hospital officials reached out to the family to admit that caregivers had erred. Eager to assure that Josie's death led to improvements in the healthcare system, the family partnered with the hospital to create the Armstrong Institute for Patient Safety and Quality, which aims to support improvement in quality and patient safety at Johns Hopkins and across the industry. Working together with a leader of the Institute, Peter Pronovost, Josie's mother, Sorrel King, became a passionate, articulate, and influential advocate for improving patient care and taking steps to reduce harm to patients. Josie's story has been heard by many, if not most, healthcare providers, along with the plea that they listen to and partner with patients and their families. Several organizations, such as the Joint Commission, the American Medical Association, and the American Hospital Association, began to provide important support for the growing safety movement. One organization that emerged as an industry leader was the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, IHI, under the direction of Don Berwick and his successors as CEO, Maureen Bisognano and Derek Feely. In 2004, IHI unveiled one of its most visible initiatives, the 100,000 Lives campaign, utilizing principles derived.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.